Europe.
They wanted to put one through reading in one of my previous. I said, no, I want them both distance. And then.
To Emmanuel Church and right to Holy Eucharist on the lawn. We're eking out a few more days of the weather, and you can see that fall has settled with us just in the past couple of days. I'm Della Wells, for those who don't know me, the rector of Emmanuel Church, and today we have as our guest musician Gynae Durakayan, and Susan Barnes will be preaching. Welcome to all of you who have come, who are here with us in this kind of blustery, portentous weather. And welcome to all of you who are joining us online. I hope I see Roger Bullard there, maybe Sandra Hill and others. Good morning. Our worship begins on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. In the spirit of creation care, we have turned to shorter bulletins and we're using our printed materials, our books. And our first hymn is God is Love, Let Heaven Adore Him, on page 379 of the Blue Hymnal.
Thank you.
worship begins on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's
We say together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Page of your bulletin. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the lesson.
The first reading is from the book of the prophet Job. Job said, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There is an upright person could reason with him. Should I be acquitted before my judge? If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart fail. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us now say together the psalm, which is on your second page of your bulletin. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? So far from my cry, from the words of my distress. Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. At night as well, I find no rest. yet you are the Holy One, enthroned above praises of Israel. Our forefathers put their trust in you, and you trusted, and you delivered. They cried out to you, and you were delivered.
They trusted in you, and were not ashamed.
But as for me, I am a worm and no man, scorned by all and despised by the people. All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads. He trusted in the Lord, but him will deliver. But he will rescue him with the gates. If you are a king, mother, believe and take me safe from my brother's trust. I have been entrusted to you since I was born. You are my God, and I was still in my mother's womb. You're not far from me, for trouble is near. There is none to help. Many are the bulls encircling me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their jaws at me, and roar at me. I am poured out by water, all my bones are out drunk. My heart and my breast is filled with noise. My mouth is crying out like a fire. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth, and you have laid me in the dust of the grave.
Reading from the book of Hebrews. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
To Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother. He said to him, Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth. Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, You lack one thing. Go. Sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples were perplexed at these words, but Jesus said to them again, Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. They were greatly astounded and said to one another, Then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible. Peter began to say to him, Look, we have left everything and followed you. Jesus said, Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you.
Of the Holy Trinity, one God. Amen. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. If you can't, raise your hand. Apparently my voice dropped off at 8 o'clock. Once, years ago, when I was mumbling about how hard it is to put together a worthy sermon, someone overheard me and said, I thought you just got them off the internet. Really?
Ouch!
No! That would not occur to me. But I do gratefully use some online resources, like something called workingpreacher.org, which I commend to all of you. It's produced by a team at Luther Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota, and they post short, thought-provoking commentaries on the week's scriptures, written by scholars and pastors with a wide range of perspectives. Since the same texts come around every 3 years, as you know, in our lectionary cycle, they also include links to commentaries from 3 years ago and 6 years ago. So I found one originally posted in 2018 by Sarah Henlicky Wilson, who was then the young pastor of a Lutheran church in Tokyo. With stunning candor, she wrote that today's gospel is, and I quote, a killer. Why? Well, even these words, even through the disciples, were a loop. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples were perplexed at these words, but Jesus said to them again, Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. Henlicky said this passage doesn't so much invite us to faith as prove how impossible faith really is. So she said, as a result, preachers and listeners tend to manage Jesus' message, to soften the hard edges. And she gave some examples of how we may do that. So here are a couple. Giving up everything was a command to this particular rich young man, but only to him. It makes no claim on anyone else. It's an object lesson in acquisitiveness. Or, it was a real command, but it applies only to the rich. All of us can think of someone richer. So by contrast, we don't qualify. That's where the ouch comes in. Like the young man, most of us are good people, following the commandments, giving our time, talent, treasure to the church and other worthy causes. But among the billions of Jesus' followers over the millennia, how many have actually done what he asked? Jesus said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own, and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When the man heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. If Jesus said the same to me today, I can't think that I would do any differently than the rich young man. So let me manage this gospel for myself and perhaps for some of you. I'm going to plead that I'm a work in progress. By this gospel's criteria, I simply do not qualify for the kingdom of God. I'm not in the 1% or even the 10% in the USA, but I am financially comfortable and indisputably rich by the world's standards. As for possessions, at 73, I'm beyond the acquisitions phase of life and more inclined to be letting things go. When I see the weight that property and possessions can lay on us as we age, I vow to purge my own stuff when I get around to it. But deaccessioning when it suits us is not what Jesus was asking. Nor was Jesus just talking about material matters, about property and stuff. Possessions are also symbolic of power and control over one's life. That's the killer for me. When I left the art world and accepted the call to the priesthood, I got a momentary inkling of the beautiful truth of losing my life to gain it. But surrendering power and control are not a one-and-done deal. If I even try, and I wish I did more often, it's an unending challenge. Jesus knows how hard this is. The gospel tells us that Jesus loved the man, even as he gave him the hard news. Jesus' tender compassion may give each of us some comfort while we struggle with it ourselves. A little story. There was a man who lived near a monastery, and he was curious about the goings-on. So he often went by, and he would linger out of curiosity. One day, there was a monk who came out when the man was standing there, and he finally screwed up the courage. He approached the monk and asked what they did in the monastery. And the monk said, "We fall down and we get up. We fall down and we get up." How do we meet the challenge of giving up our lives for the sake of the gospel? We fall down and we get up. We accept that we continually fall short and that we can do better with God's help. One day, one word, one thought, one choice, one action at a time. I truly believe that God loves us and will walk with us on the way to transformation. And if I do make the grade, I'll be very happy to be at the end of the line. Key to that is listening to God's call, committing to times of silence daily, shutting out the competing clamor and distractions of contemporary life, and acting on the calls that we hear. In this stewardship season, as you pray about how you will share your earthly treasure and your time and your spiritual gifts with Emmanuel in the coming year, I hope you will also renew your commitment to daily prayer, taking time to hear God's ever-faithful call. And remember, for God, all things are possible. Amen.
Amen.
standing as you are able, we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed on page 355 of your Books of Common Prayer, 358. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made in man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our Bishop Nicholas, our presiding Bishop Michael, for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and for our community of Emmanuel, and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, for our President Joseph, our Governor Daniel, our Mayor Jean Marie, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. Almighty and everlasting God, our days are in your hands. We lift up all those in the Holy Land who are victims of violence and injustice, that you might empower your church to bring healing to the wounded, relief to the suffering, and comfort to those who mourn. We pray also that you would soften the hearts of all those involved in the recent conflicts, that they would be led to work for justice and lasting peace in the land where your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, first came to bring hope and abundant life to all people. These things we ask in his holy name. I pray for the Holy Land. I ask your prayers for Janet, Dion, Brian, Jill, Annie, Ellie, Ash, Paula, Don, Patty, Carol, Michael, Scott, Joan, Ruth, Joanne, Deb, Rick, Matthew, Donna, Bridget, Bill, Vanessa, Julie, Nellie, Vanda, Natalie, Patrice, Allison, and Jackie Breen's son, Christopher. Pray that they may find and be found by God. I ask your prayers for the departed, especially Don Champion, who died October 8th. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day. The people may add their own petitions.
For the earth, we may care for her.
For all those who flee political violence and environmental violence. Lord, hear the prayers of your people. And what we have asked faithfully, grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Gathering our thoughts in prayer and preparation, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
by what we have done,
and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
We are truly sorry,
and we humbly repent.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on us and forgive us,
that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please greet one another with a sign of peace. Hello to all of those of you online. We greet you now. Hello to all of you. So glad you've joined us.
Peace,
Bobby. So when you're totally peaced out, have a seat, please. It's really good to see everybody here today. I'm so glad everyone has come, and thank you for your patience and for all of us. As you know, we're trying to stay out as long as we can to get ahead of the virus and the surge. And while we're still in that red zone of high transmission, we are hopeful that the numbers are trending down. And it looks like we are at the end of what is a now scientifically inexplicable two-month cycle. We don't know what that means yet, but it seems that the virus surges over two-month periods and then it drops back. I'm sure there's science in that. I'm sure the scientists believe there's science in that. We just don't know what it is yet. But we're about at the end of the surge, and when the virus is down, we will enjoy the privileges of being less worried about transmission indoors, and we'll move back indoors with masks on. I want to invite Nick Brown, our pledge speaker today, to come and give his pledge report, if he can come forward.
Nick, be sure to use the mic. Yeah, get it up.
Well, Taylor Maine.
There you go.
Well, as you know, the theme for this year's parish stewardship campaign is God makes all things new. We heard a little bit about what God thinks about wealth earlier from a brilliant sermon by Susan. It's a little difficult for me because I guess I'm about as hidebound traditionalist as there is. Newness is not always welcome. What is going on when a family of four are all reading their cell phones as they sit around the dinner table? And what's happened to the necktie? What's happened to everything that we used to know? And then there is the parallel issue of change. It ain't what it used to be. I've said that, and I guess many of you have too. I was recently reading the story of the Eiffel Tower in Paris, and the major pushback it received from many quarters during its construction. The city of Providence is going through the same heated debate right now over the famed tower proposal. It would build quite a skyscraper down in what used to be the jewelry district. Change is uncomfortable. But look around and see so many examples of where change has been beneficial to us. The electronic means of communicating with our loved ones, air conditioning, light, heat, automobiles, all of that. That is change. Sometimes it didn't come easily, but now that it's here, we welcome it. So it's a hard thing change. But no change has been more beneficial to than the twinning of Emmanuel Church and the Newport Music Festival, which is now brilliantly, brilliantly called Classical Newport to mark its year-round vocation. Yeah, I guess I'm a little biased in that. It was my mother who substantially founded the Newport Music Festival, and of course, my grandmother who built our church. So I guess I have a dog in the fight. But that these two organizations have come together is a most beneficial, symbiotic relationship that certainly does show that God is making new. And also using his emissary, our beloved Rector Della, who conjoined her lawyerly skills and her priestly skills to create something very special. But how does all this affect us? What does newness do for our parish? I'd like to sidestep the potentially negative implications of new or change and offer another word, refreshment. Isn't this the essence of what renewal is all about? In the Episcopal service, our prayers are mostly written. The rubrics of the liturgy are prescriptive. And this inevitably will lead to rote recital unless newness and change bring refreshment. Happily for us all, our prayer book offers many alternatives. That is what refreshes. So the next time that Della opts for another form of the prayer of consecration, let us listen to the new formulation rather than regret the absence of more familiar words. Let these words penetrate. Of course, all this, the fabric of our church, our rector and her staff, even light and heat, are here because of us. That is what a parish is, us. I feel safe in predicting that each one of us finds refreshment in church in a personal and probably different way. But corporately, we are grains of sand coming together to form a beach. So in this time of reflection on our stewardship, we are each called to contemplate how this parish refreshes us, and then to look with utmost seriousness on how to ensure that we value this and that we will continue doing all we reasonably can to contribute to the support of our parish. God may make all things new, but he depends on each of us to respond with our material support. So we must do what he asks. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick, for that eloquent and important call to action for our parish. I just want to comment a little bit on the Newport Music Festival, now Newport Classical. We have our signs up, as you see. Those went up on Friday, and the corner sign will be replaced when it is available. They're having a little bit of difficulty with the materials, so that'll be later in the month. The banner that represents Newport Classical sign is now wrapped around the lower poles. The sign itself, the infrastructure for it, will be replaced with newer, sturdier materials. And I understand it will all be made of the same wood-like material that is impervious to our seaside climate, and will be much longer lasting without delaminating and without discoloring like the other materials did. So the sign for Emmanuel Church will have beautiful, clear, crisp print together with our Emmanuel cross and the Episcopal shield, so it will be more colorful and broadcast out that we are an Episcopal congregation in a new way, and then have removable service times and all of that. It'll be great. So that we expect later on this month. The Newport Music Festival, now I keep doing that, now Newport Classical had its second concert in its inaugural first season on Friday evening. Kristen Lee played violin, accompanied by Kwan Yi, who was, I mean, they were amazing as a duo and played a wonderful French-based concert in the perfect acoustics of the Newport Classical Recital Hall. So it was a lovely evening. So thank you for all you say. And just as my dean at the Divinity School used to say, we will change the Eucharistic prayers and we will change the prayers of the people with the next season. So at the All Saints Day, we will change to another Eucharistic prayer and another form of the prayers. He used to say we did that so that everybody had a chance to feel equally bewildered and disappointed. So stick around long enough and all things will become new your way again. Are there any other matters for the good of the order? Does anybody have any questions or comments or anything else?
Della, you might just say that the Lord has provided incredible acoustics.
Yes.
Nobody knew,
yes.
But it is probably the most brilliantly dosed,
yes,
sound that you can possibly have. Yes. And who would have thunk that a basketball court would have done that?
As Nick said, who'd have thunk it? It is that the acoustics in the recital hall are just astonishing. And Trevor Neal, the world-class baritone, who is the artistic director of the Newport Classical, on his first tour, he used that great big voice and spoke out in the recital hall, and he said the acoustics in here are more live than they are in the nave.
Yes.
So as Nick said, who'd have thunk it, but it is true. The acoustics are amazing, and at one point, the soloist came forward, and the mic was ringing a little bit. There was a little bit of feedback. So she stepped to center stage, and Nick and I were seated way in the back. I heard every word clearly.
Absolutely.
Clearly.
So that's God operating for us.
God has given us beautiful acoustics in this amazing building, and that's just part of the wonderful form factor that Emmanuel Church has. As a mission of Trinity Church, the Church of the People, it was built by its donors, by Nick's family. It was built to honor the folks who worked in the houses and the tradespeople who didn't have their own gymnasiums, ballrooms, and recital halls at home. And so that is why we have these lovely things to share with the whole community. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High.
Thank you. special driver's license for that.
Yeah, I know. What? I'm not licensed to drive the little red wagon.
That's right.
All things come of thee, O Lord.
And of thine own have we given thee.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood we reconcile us, by his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope to proclaim with them your glory and their unending hymn. Redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them so that they may be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord by your Holy Spirit. On the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving,
we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
Lord God of our fathers, God of Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah and Jacob and Rachel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength. For pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah! Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
People of God, feed on God in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Standing as you are able, we say together our post-communion prayer found on page 365 of your books of common prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. May the God of Abraham and Sarah and of Jesus Christ, born of our sister Mary and of the Holy Spirit who broods over the earth like a mother broods over her children, keep you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia.